Hey there, YouTube! Are you ready for a product review? A negative atheist asking the age-old question, is this thing worth my money? Hello and welcome back to another product review by A Negative Atheist. So today we are going to be looking at one of my favorite board games, that is Letters from Whitechapel. This was made by Fantasy Flight Games and is, in fact, one of the very first board games that I purchased, kind of outside of the normal Milton Bradley and mass-marketed board games. This was a game that my wife actually picked out, and surprisingly enough, or maybe not so surprising if you've seen my channel, we love this game, and this game kind of got us propelled into the board gaming hobby to begin with. Now, why in particular this game, and why do we like it so much? So Letters from Whitechapel, this is the revised edition, as you can see there in the camera, and I'm sorry if I get out of focus here, I can't actually see my camera, but I think I've got everything set up. So this game is for 2 to 6 players, and essentially in this game you're going to have one player playing the bad guy, and all of the other players, between 1 and 5 additional players, playing a group of police officers trying to catch him. So this makes this game an asymmetric game. And because the bad guy moves in a way that is disguised from all of the other players, it's also a hidden movement game. Now, I've seen some reviews back and forth on this game on whether or not people like it, and I think the general consensus is that people like it, but it could have been better. I pretty firmly disagree. I think this game is marvelous. The kind of theme, the thematics of the game are really well captured in the way it was created, and we've played this game a ton. I mean, an absolute ton. My 11-year-old and I have played it on our own now that she's getting a little bit older. It is about Jack the Ripper and the Whitechapel district in London and the murders subsequently thereupon, but it's a very interesting game. It's fun, and if you took the theme out of it, I think it would still be fun, but the theme certainly captures a certain feeling within this. You can see just right here on the cover that it is going to be a little on the darker side of the theme, but it's very good. Here's the sides of the box. Hopefully you can see all of that. It's just basically the same printing all around. Set that aside for you. Here's what you're gonna get inside. There's a map. Now this map is huge. I'm not actually even going to be able to show you all of it on the camera. Folds out here, and folds out here as well, and it will completely cover up your table. Go ahead and unfold it quite a bit for you so I can show you exactly what I'm talking about here. Like I said, I'm not going to be able to get it all in the frame because it is significantly large. This is what your map looks like. Hopefully you can at least see some of it. This is a map of the entire district of Whitechapel. I'm not entirely sure how historically accurate it is. It's your basic playing surface, so you've got all these little markers, dotted lines, etc. And that all comes into the way that you move and the way you move about the board. Folds down like so, and like so. So I would say these tiles are probably 1x1, so that would probably make it a 3x2 board. Could be off on that. I've not actually measured it. Also in the box, you're going to get this little screen that kind of serves as a game master screen or dungeon master screen if you're into role-playing games. If not, then they call it the Jack screen. You can see here on the bottom. Now, I understand that there's a revised edition out, like a further revision out now that gives you a little bit more detail. This is a card that I've inserted from a previous game, but gives you a little bit of the information on which icons you get on each of the four knights. The game is arranged in four knights. And this lets you track where Jack's hideout is. Each one of the turns, the movement turns during each one of the knights represented here across the top. And these are the pre-murder spots. You can wait before you commit a murder. And then these are the actual movement turns. If you wait all the way until 15, then Jack gets caught out in the daylight. Each one of these represents the knight you're on, corresponding to here. And then you write in where you moved to, and then how you moved, etc. So that is the screen. Next you have some character cards. This is Jack the Ripper's card. And it covers how the movements work, or how each turn works. So the first part, you have hell, it's kind of the killing part. Second part is hunting, where they try to chase Jack and he escapes into the night, or at least that's his objective. Now, these next cards are the different patrol units, and there are five of them in total. Each one has a color on it, as you can see. And these are basically your what you can do in your turn card, but they also have a little bit of individuality to them. Based on the color, you have a corresponding unit type. And you can play with the unit types and add in a certain flavor to the game. We don't usually do that. You got your rule book. Now, I will tell you that one of the things that bothered me about this game was the rule book was not entirely concise. There is a little bit of flipping back and forth. It's not a huge rule book. There's 23 pages. I have seen much thicker rule books. I think, you know, Fantasy Flight tends to have decently concise rules, and this one is on the harder end. I've heard a lot of people describe this game as a slightly more complex version of Sherlock Holmes or some other games that are out there that are hidden movement detective type scenarios. Once you understand this game, and there are some videos online on how to play that make it a little bit easier to understand, but once you understand this game, it becomes pretty straightforward. There's not really a good ability to learn as you play. However, if you go off of one of the videos online, I think that you can get the rules consistently enough to learn the rest of it as you play. We did make a couple errors the first time we played, and it didn't really ruin the game. It just ended the game earlier or later than it should have. But the feeling was still there. It was still very fun. So there are these tokens that you use to randomly select who the leader of the police force are for the night. So you would shuffle these, and this is who the boss, the head detective, if you will, for that night is. You can choose whether or not you use these, and if you're only having one player, it really doesn't matter all that much. But there's that. And when I say one player, I mean one player on the detective side. Of course, the lowest amount of players you can have in this game are two still. One being Jack the Ripper, and one being the detectives. So these are tokens that Jack would get based on which knight you're on. They were kind of shown in that screen image that I showed you earlier, but he would physically receive these tokens and then use them during his night, and this is just a way of keeping track out of how many that he still has. When he uses these, he does reveal them to all the players on the board so that you know how many moves he makes and what type of moves he might have made, which kind of helps you track him down. It is pretty difficult to track Jack down, especially on the first night, you have to get some context as to generally where he is headed. There are several tokens, as you can see here in the box. You have the Jack the Ripper token. There's two of those that mark where his movement is. It doesn't show where he's at on the board, but it shows how he's made moves throughout the night. There are these pawns that you'll have some that are white on the bottom and some that are red on the bottom when it comes to these little white tokens, and the red ones represent potential targets, and then you will replace them with the wretched tokens, which are Jack's potential targets for the evening. And then of course you have the police officer tokens. They're just kind of, not quite meeples, but nondescript wooden tokens. They're all wooden tokens, except for the clue markers, which are clear plastic. Everything else is wooden. It's pretty well made game overall. The quality is very decent. There are also these black tokens that have colors corresponding to the police officers underneath them. And there are some that are black on the bottom because they are decoys. So both Jack and the police officers get to place up some decoys in a hidden setup phase that sets the initial scene. You have some clue markers and some tokens where you represent the murders that have occurred. Jack can leave clues behind his trail there, and then he also can leave some potentially fake clues behind as well. And what else you get in this? There are lots of little bags to hold all your tokens. I didn't put this game well away last time. I usually am pretty good about that, but not always. There are some letters that Jack can give off to throw off the search party. And these letters have specific rules that allow Jack to essentially move some of the other tokens around on the board. And then it comes with lots of sheets, and you can see we've played with quite a few of them. I like to save them just because nostalgia and whatnot, but it's basically a notepad, and you could always print more off just on computer paper if you just scan it and copy it. I don't see a problem with that. It still worked the same. And that is it for what's inside the box. Now, might be asking yourself, well, there's not a whole lot in there. As you can tell, it's got quite a few void places. How fun is this game? So this game will take you several hours to play. I can tell you that for certain. It says on the back here it takes 1+ hours. I can tell you from personal experience that it usually is quite a bit longer. I would say the 1 hour mark is not typical. That would be if you catch Jack on the first or second turn, and typically an inexperienced Jack player might have this issue, but I would say that for the most part that doesn't tend to happen. The first couple of times you play this game, I would recommend playing with somebody that's played it before and have that person be Jack, because they would understand the rules, and I believe that's even stated in the rule book. However, as you go on playing it, sometimes it's fun just to have somebody that's not all that familiar with playing Jack play, and this is a game that gets better with time. So the more that you play the game, and it's not one that hits my board every night by any means, not even every month, but you know, on the once or twice a year that we play this game, we always have a whole lot of fun. It usually lasts us anywhere from 2 to 3, sometimes 4 hours on the high side. The good thing is it doesn't take all that long to set up, and if you're already familiar with the rules, it is a game that you can just kind of play as you go, and for new players playing, if you have at least one experienced player, you can learn it on the fly. You can give them all of the general rules and what the expected outcomes are, and just kind of go with the flow on learning the game. I highly recommend this game for anybody that wants to get into board games outside of your traditional Monopoly or Clue or what have you. This will give you some new elements to your board gaming hobby. If you are already into some of the non-traditional board games and you want to expand your collection, you want to play something that has cooperative elements but still has a little bit of competition. As I said before, this is an asymmetrical board game. It does have hidden movement elements, and what you're essentially doing is Jack the Ripper, it will be on one side, he will commit one or two murders, and then he will have to escape while he is hidden from view back to his home base location where he will then be safe. The police officers then pursue him throughout the night, looking for clues and trying to figure out where his ultimate hiding place is. So as you can imagine, at first you can leave some false trails or you can take the long way home and kind of throw people off of where you are heading to, but as the game goes on, it becomes more and more apparent where Jack is going to, and it becomes much harder and more difficult for him to escape. This game is very fun. Like I said, it doesn't always hit my table, but when it does, we always have a blast. It is a game where you can take your time and develop good conversations in between your turns. You can sit down and enjoy a meal, or what have you. It's a game that we quite like a lot, and I highly recommend it. So if you haven't already, check out Letters from Whitechapel by Fantasy Flight Games, and I will see you in the next video. Thank you so much, and goodbye. I have attached affiliate links for this product in the description below. I do, full disclaimer here, get a commission from Amazon at no additional charge to you, so please, if you feel like buying this product, use that to support this channel and future content. I am not sponsored in any way by this product or its parent company, and the opinions here are solely my own, and you can use them as you will. Thanks, as always. Go ahead and like this video if you like it. Go ahead and subscribe if you want to see more future content, and I will see you in the next one.